We were kind of talking about this yesterday when we were warming up for the show, this idea that it is this economic stimulus, and sometimes it gets maligned, and people talk about it a lot, specifically with administration changes. And I feel like that's already present here in the Q&A. So let's just grab the bull by the horns, right? Lee Bishop is asking about knowing that this new administration is thinking about changing tax deferral methods. Do you think this is a smokescreen to scare investors? And you told me you've been around this block a couple of times, right? Like you've
Oh,
seen
yeah.
this before. Why don't you give us a little bit of perspective on
Yeah,
that?
you know, it's interesting when your career is connected to the Internal Revenue Code. We all see in our world is kind of like we have a target on our back a little bit. This is nothing new. I think it goes all the way back to the Clinton administration, even our last administration. So, you know, whenever they're looking for pay for, if there is not the knowledge of 1031, it looks like a great way to, okay, how do we pay for, like, for example, in the recent 2022 reconciliation budget resolution, you know, well, how do you pay for all these things? So the last administration was a total repeal. What is proposed now is with a 500,000 cap per individual or per taxpayer in a given year. So, you know, IPX is kind of working very hard with other qualified intermediaries and industry groups to educate Congress and explain how, you know, the 1031 is that economic stimulus. And so we're positive about it, but in terms of it not happening, but we're also worried about it too. So you'll see on our website at ipx1031.com, you'll see there's a big red strip there. If you hit on that, you can send a letter to your congressman, because it is really important that it remains the way that it is, so that, you know, the average exchanger and even exchange is 500,000 or less, but still there's that situation where, you know, it could affect a lot of businesses and larger transactions as well.
Yeah, you got to think about it from an economic driver perspective. There's the advantages of the 1031, which continue to encourage long-term investments and additional properties coming online, with the great thing that does for the community, the tax base, all that good stuff. But you got to think, if you know, if you're just thinking about the liquidity of money, if I'm sitting in California and I'm sitting on a huge gain and I don't want to pay the taxes on it right now, I'm just going to sit on that property. I'm not going to sell it anymore. So you got to think about that across the entire country, right? That stops the liquidity of money, right? And then when money's not changing hands, goods and services aren't being purchased. So you got to think that there's other things that would be less damaging to go down that path,
right?
If we're trying to find the money to pay for some of the things that we're doing from the government's perspective. But
absolutely, you know, like if you think of some of our exchangers that own, you know, a warehouse for their business, and they want to now exchange it into a larger warehouse, well, maybe they wouldn't do that, right? Because they don't want to pay the tax, so they'll just build. But good point, Greg. Yeah,
that makes a lot of sense. And Claudia, last time around, right? Like we. Real estate, right? We talk about cycles. And this is another cycle, right? An administration change affects that type of stuff. Last time around, can you talk about kind of what they threatened and then what ended up happening as far as taking away a 1031 exchange?
Oh,
and what ended
well,
up going
yeah,
on?
It was part of the, you know, a pay for the Tax Cuts and Job Act. And so it was a total repeal. They did, at that time, they did get rid of and repealed exchanges for personally. You know, as a company, we did exchanges not only for real estate, but we did exchanges for like business equipment, like cranes and trucks. And we did exchanges for airplanes and franchises. You know, if you have someone selling a hotel, they may have had the real estate they're doing an exchange on, and then maybe also the franchise. We even had the original exchanges of livestock, right? So that no longer is available to our exchangers. So we only do the real estate at this point. But, you know, what it just took was, you know, like anything, is just educating at that time the Republicans about, you know, what a 1031 is and why it's been around so long and the many different positive things we've been talking about.
You know, knowing that you had that perspective of seeing it being challenged before and then seeing some elements of it being taken away, not real estate, but those other things that you were just talking about. I think of like a worst case scenario. Let's just say that the most recent suggestions of capping it were in place. When could you foresee that first time taking effect and affecting somebody who's listening to the show right now and
yeah,
limiting their ability?
I don't know. Not quite sure. Maybe in probably next year, if it did go through. I think that there's some significant timelines in that I think it's, there's a committee, I think in September sometime. So we should know.
We'll know in the fall, there will be some period after that. So worth it. And from what I'm understanding from you, it's not on the table to totally axe the 1031. What's on the table is to cap it at $500,000.
Right. Of gain, not the sale price. So a married couple would be $1 million, right?
Married couple. Okay. And is that in one calendar year?
Yes. That's my understanding.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. All right. So that's what we're, that's potentially on the table. And that most likely wouldn't be implemented until sometime next year. We know how government works. So it's good to understand what potentially a worst case scenario could be here.
Yeah, yes. It's good to understand that. And you see, you know, I go back to kind of what we talked about during COVID time, right? This idea that real estate is its own asset class in the eyes of the regulators and the eyes of the government and the eyes of the people, and that it's this like necessary thing that really, really drives economy, right? Like really drives multiple levels of our economy. And while, you know, Uncle Sam isn't as passionate about you upgrading to a bigger pig, buddy, sorry. You know, they do care. It does affect on many, many different levels, upgrading housing and or exchanging, like Claudia said, from one warehouse to another. And the way that it all trickles down affects so many sectors of the economy that's really hard to mess with, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, I definitely see your point. I mean, what the point you're making is all through COVID, right? There's a reason why all the stimulus money went to support housing. It went to support people in their house. And it wasn't just because the government wants people in their home for the people's sake. The government wants people in their homes for the government's sake, for the country's sake, right? It's a critical need. You know, the only thing that I would say that might not be going in our direction here, everything you're saying as far as real estate is absolutely true, but you know, 1031s are not known by the mass public, right? It is something that is enjoyed by savvy investors, and those things tend to have a bullet on their back, you know? So I don't know. I'm just trying to think about it from the opposite perspective. I think you could say, well, that's a target that could easily be, you know, vilified.
Except, you know, when you do look at our exchangers, you know, they're mostly, you know, people like myself, right? They have, you know, a couple single family rental homes, or they're farmers, or so it would really kind of affect a lot of people. But yeah.
Yeah, makes sense. All right. So that is the uncertain future, you know, kind of discussion that I'm glad we got out of the way.